Hey everyone, it's Kong again, and here's another episode of Should You Summon. I'm really proud to be at the point where we can have back-to-back crossover episodes. I really love this community, and I love how we all kind of work together to help each other, and I'm really glad that I can be a part of bringing people together like this. As always, I'm not going to be presenting in-depth guides or builds for these characters, but rather high-level overviews using these four criteria to help you decide whether it's worth spending your hard-earned vouchers and crystals on this banner. How they fit into your team, whether they unlock any bonds, what kind of content they get used for, and their future availability. So, this is a Destiny banner featuring Rachel, Tiaris, and Lana, and it runs from September 17th to the 30th. As a Destiny banner, your first SSR pull is guaranteed to be one of these that you don't already have. And after you pull that first SSR, it reverts to a normal raid-up banner, where you can start pulling off-banner heroes and duplicates. So first, let's get started with Rachel. Rachel is a mage with a great combo of AoE and single-target skills, with extra healing and utility thrown in for good measure. Her talent allows her to remove debuffs and heal surrounding allies after she does damage, including AoEs. Her 3-cost skill is a big AoE blast that causes several stacks of fixed damage, and she has Gospel, and she floats. Thanks to the recent release of the new Scepter of Divinity, Rachel is now often able to use her powerful single-target spells like Dark Reaper and Holy Word at 3 range, meaning she can more easily attempt to spike Landius and other range units. She's a member of Protagonists, buffed by Matthew, and Yeles Legends, buffed by Landius and Sigma. For bonds, she unlocks the defensive bond for Lambda and the all-important attack bond for Landius. And this fact alone is enough to make her worth summoning for many people. For her own bonds, she needs Angelina for her defensive bond and Landius for her own attack bond. For content, in PvE, she's on faction against Phoenix in Eternal Temple, and she's also great against the Ice Dragon for obvious magical reasons. In Ancient Beckoning, she's on faction for Hugin and Munin, but she's one of the top meta picks against Nidhogg. In PvP, she's quite a common threat in Apex Arena boxes, both for her magical power and versatility, and because she has access to Gospel. This allows her to protect against mean debuffs, and also provide a pseudo-buff to characters in case you have to deploy someone without access to their fusion power. This helps give you a lot of freedom and flexibility in your ban pick phase. For availability, in addition to the early February return of this same banner, Rachel will also be showing up on a Destiny banner in mid-November with Leden and Ultimuller. And that's another banner that gets rerun every once in a while, so it's one that you'll kind of gradually be able to pick characters off of until you've used up all your Destiny guarantees. Okay, next let's talk about Tiaris. Tiaris is hands down one of the best characters in the game overall. She's a mobile healer with great support skills in Attack Blessing and Miracle, as well as a talent that gives surrounding heroes ongoing passive healing. Tiaris, paired with a strong tank, forms the core of many successful teams. Notably, there's no sign of a 3-cost skill or unique equipment for Tiaris, because she's already so good that the devs don't have any pressing need to patch her up quite yet. She's a member of Protagonists, buffed by Matthew, Origins of Light, buffed by Dehart, Jugler, and Freya, and Princess Alliance, buffed by Shelfaniel and Luna. For bonds, she unlocks the defensive bond for Geralt and Layla, and the attack bond for Dehart. And her own bonds are exactly the same, she needs Geralt and Layla for her defensive bond, and Dehart for her attack bond. For content, in PvE, she gets used for everything. Literally everything. Story, time rifts, event challenges, secret realm, joint battles. This includes Ancient Beckoning battles against Hugin and Munin, Jormungandr, and Nidhogg. For PvP, she used to be a solid meta pick in PvP, but she has dropped off as competition for healer slots has ramped up. Every box needs a handful of healers, and there are now a lot of options, each with their own pros and cons. Lyanna, Sophia, Iris, Wheeler, and the upcoming Florentia and Rosenseal, and heck, Close is still in the mix. One of Tiaris's problems in PvP is that she doesn't have that extra special little side dish of utility that many other healers have. She's still great for protecting your tank from back-to-back single target attempts, and for attack blessing, so if you've got her built up for PvE and your other healers aren't quite developed, then just throw her in your box. Okay, if there's one thing I learned from last week's episode, it's that people are hungry for more accent content. And coincidentally, the premier Langrisser content creator and strategist in Russia happens to use Lana all the time, even in PvP. So I'm going to hand it over to her for some more in-depth insights.
Hello guys, this is Enro. I play on the Salroth server and I'm also a strategist. I mostly do my videos for the Russian audience, for those of us who don't understand English quite well. I've been invited here today to talk about my poster girl, Lana, since I've been using her for 4 Apex seasons in a row, until I finally benched her for the upcoming season. And of course I'm gonna tell you why I did that. But first, let us mention the basics. Lana is an extremely strong single-target mage with a variety of nukes at her disposal, although she does have quite a few AoE spells and even a summoning skill. Her factions are Dark, buffed by Bozel and Licorice, and Princess, buffed by Luna and Shelfaniel. For bonds, she only unlocks Sonya's attack bond, and for her own bonds, she needs Leon and Elwyn best boys. Be aware of that because you won't be able to use her to full potential without her attack bond unlocked. Her talent only gives her plus 30% magic damage when she's attacking, so it doesn't work with her AoE. Her plus one range applies only to Lana herself, not her troops, so please be aware of that. If you attack with a skill from range 3, her troops will not attack, and that will severely reduce the amount of damage she can deal. But speaking of range, her 3C has already been released, and it allows her to attack from range 3 with her troops and is super effective against infantry, cavalry, lancers and flyers, so it boosts her ST potential even further. To play Lana, you absolutely need her unique equipment, because it inflicts one random powerful debuff on her enemy before their attack, further boosting her nuke power and making it possible for her to make full use of the staff Astaroth, which can be more or less considered Lana's another special equipment. Let's talk about her PvP usage now. Lana is a heavy-hitting glass cannon single-target mage and has an option to throw a black hole for the sake of debuffs here and there. Her nuke power is astonishingly strong, and she's more than able to one-shot Juggler or take one life off Landius. I must mention that one of her basic nukes, Dark Reaper, ignores 30% of the target's magic defense, so for high magic defense targets, I actually prefer Reaper over her 3C skill. Her main disadvantages are short legs, no support skills like Gospel or Mass Attack, and, even more importantly, the inability to execute her Astaroth plus unique equipment combo on Gospel targets. Throughout the seasons, the amount of Gospel unit has increased dramatically in Apex boxes, and it's not getting better later, with future introduction of Rose and Seal. Thus, Lana has long been benched and is no longer used in PvP. But that certainly doesn't stop her from being the absolute queen of PvE content. She's on faction for Leviar in the Eternal Temple, Nidhogg and Fenrir in Ancient Beckoning, and she's absolutely godlike there. Along with her heavy nukes, she brings the Magic Defense Intimidate skill that decreases her enemy's magic defense by 20%, making them softer for all other magic users on your team. Don't forget to bring her along for your Timeless Trials or some nasty event challenges. She excels at everything PvE, basically. Just don't forget to protect her, she's a squishy.
Thanks so much for your valuable experience and analysis, Anaril. So here's the quick and dirty. We have Rachel, who's a versatile single-target and AoE magical threat. She unlocks the defensive bond for Lambda and the attack bond for Landius. And she's a top pick versus Nidhogg, as well as being a popular pick in Apex Arena as one of a handful of Gospel users. Then we have Tiaris, who's a top-tier PvE healer who still has some crossover value in PvP. She unlocks the defensive bond for Geralt and Layla and the attack bond for Dehart, and seriously, she feels like cheat mode in PvE. If you don't have her, you need to get her. And we have Lana, who's a powerful magical nuke with great range, who unlocks the attack bond for Sonya. I'd say it's highly recommended to summon on this banner, each character for a kind of different reason. Tiaris is the closest thing to an essential character in this game, and Rachel unlocks the attack bond for Landius, who's still one of the meta tanks, and a character that you absolutely need, at least in PvP, but really up there for PvE as well. And finally, just a reminder about upcoming banners. Next week, this banner will overlap with the launch of the new characters Rosalia and Nomi. When this banner expires in 2 weeks, it'll be replaced with a raid-up banner featuring Wheeler and Young Jessica. Since there's a lot of big stuff happening in the next few weeks, I suppose I might as well mention the week after will be the first Destiny banner to feature Ares. So if you missed him in his debut, you might think it's worth risking his banner mates Betty and Amelia for the chance to get him here. After that, the Landius, Jugler, and Yulia banner makes another return, and Landius could be a great companion for Rachel if you pull her here. Alright, I hope you found this video helpful. If so, and you haven't already, why not tap that subscribe button before you go? Also, let me know in the comments who you're hoping to summon and what kind of luck you had. Thanks always for watching, and I'll catch you in the next Should You Summon.